Okay, I want to introduce you to some JPS. That's Jeff Positioning System. Not GPS, but Jeff Positioning. This is a hub stake. This is a grade feather or whisker. You're going to take this, you're going to put it on the stick, you're going to pull it back like that and smack it with Grapthar's hammer. And that's going to install it. Why are these sticking out of the ground? Because we're putting 3/4 in here, and Matt needed to put them in and then go do something else. So if I take these out, I'm going to have to go get the laser and put them back myself. But I'm not going to. I'm just going to roll this 3/4 over and over the top, and then I'm going to be grading over the top of these. And these work really well. It's old school technology, but sometimes GPS doesn't work. Depending on where your location is, or cloud cover and stormy, whatever. Maybe some kind of malfunction. So if you want to be a blade hand, you need to know how to cut these. You need to know how to use them. And it takes some practice. But after you've done it for a while, you'll figure it out and you'll get good at it. So running a motor grader takes some patience. It does take some skill, but mostly you got to be a patient person, because you're going to cuss and swear and scream at it because you can't make it do things you want it to do. My advice is, if you want to be a blade hand, don't be scared of it. GPS does a lot of cool stuff, but you still got to be able to run that blade. You got to understand how to move the material and what works and what doesn't work. And it's really easy to tell a good blade hand when you see one running a blade. You just know. You watch him work and you go, yep, that guy knows what he's doing. And I had to learn the hard way. Nobody taught me. I just watched it, watched some things that were done, then got in one and went to town. Did a lot of cussing, a lot of swearing. I used to cut cellar walls, potato cellar walls. I used to build dirt cellars. Well, you'd take dirt and you'd stack it 8 or 10 feet tall, pack the crap out of it, and then you would cut the inside walls till they were almost straight up and down with a motor grader. And I'm not kidding you, I can't tell you how many times you'd swing that blade up and cut and cut. Then you'd bring it down and you'd pull the material out and you'd get a scraper and you'd clean that up. And I would take 13 feet of fill off the bottom of them till I got them to where I wanted them. And they had to be straight. And you do a lot of cussing, I'm here to tell you. But you learn. You need to be able to run a blade without GPS. That's really important. If you can't cut grade the old school way with the feathers, you're no good to anybody. Also, it takes an eye for grade. I mean, guys that have been in blades a long time, they can look at stuff and go, that's low, that's high. That's a 1-to-1 slope. That's a 1.5-to-1 slope. That's my 2 cents. Let's go grade some 3/4. When you're pushing 3/4 windrow, you don't want your moldboard tipped all the way forward. Now, if you've seen guys grading it with their moldboard all the way forward, you only do that when you're cutting fine grade. Because what happens when you roll that moldboard all the way forward is, it's like taking a pocket knife and instead of turning it to the sharp side, you turn it to the other side and you're like spreading butter. Well, if you get a huge blade full, it's going to want to start lifting your blade up, and it's going to do this with your blade. And so to do this, I'm going to have my moldboard rolled back probably about in the middle so it's straight up and down, and then I'm not going to take a huge bite. I'm going to go with a small bite first, spread it out. I'm going to try to send it over against these hub stakes and the feathers as close as I can. Okay, now I'm gonna turn around and push it back the other way. So my Michelin grader tire has developed a boil. Should I take a drill bit and drill that? Some kind of abscess going on there. Maybe I need to drain that. Do you think that's like a buildup of tire fluid or something? I don't know. Somebody tell me what I should do with that. Because I'm not, but I don't know what to do with that. I'm at a loss there.
Coming up next on TV Land, it's Green Acres, the classic rural sitcom with a little something for everyone. Whether you're a connoisseur of self-reflexive humor, or just think it's funny when people say Hooterville.
This has been a Filmways presentation, darling.
Okay, she's got a bath. So what have I got to do to this? Well, the wheeling cylinder was leaking like a sieve. So that's got to come off and get resealed. This circle valve here for the hydraulics is leaking. That's got to come off and get resealed. And the side shift cylinder is leaking. That's got to get resealed. It's due for an engine oil change. Clean the magnetic filter on the transmission and change the transmission filter. Grease it. Make sure everything's in working order. And let's see, what else? Oh, a new set of tires.
She's got to have a new set of tires before we go on to our new job. And I don't know if I told you about that or not, but we've got us a new job for the BLM. And we're going to grade some roads and place cinders on them. And the boys are getting their trucks ready to go. We're going to use the trucks to spread the cinders. I got to get it started and get it warmed up and get that oil dumped.
Okay, this is the transmission filter housing on the grader, and since it's a high pressure housing, you can't use a spin on, so it's a cartridge type. And this is the filter that goes in it. This is a cat filter. These are pretty dang good filters. I like the way they're built. Rubber ends, they seal around there. So anyway, that's gonna go in here. Okay, and then I'll go out and screw this up on there after I replace this gas or O-ring on there.
Okay, this is the wheeling cylinder off the motor grader. I took it off last night and I couldn't get this head loose. And I was using this 4 foot long pipe wrench. Anyway, so what I did is I took some of this liquid wrench and I tipped this cylinder down. Anyway, I sprayed a bunch of it in the threads here. So good thing I wasn't filming this morning, but I expected this to really come off difficult. So I put it in there and I started hanging on that wrench. Anyway, I just ended up on my ass on the floor. It was quite embarrassing, but it came loose. I don't know what they've put in liquid wrench, but man, I'm not kidding you. That stuff works, and it works good. So now it's time to get this head off. Okay, I need to protect this chrome when this comes off, so I'm going to put a ton of tape over it. Okay, look at how wet the threads are. And in there, that liquid wrench went in there. I mean, I hung on the end of that 4 foot wrench just jerking and pulling on it. I thought I was going to pull the vise off the table. That's an awesome vise too, by the way. Thanks, David. I love you. Every time I use that, I think of you. That's cool. Anyway, so liquid wrench works, and it works good. Oh yeah, oil. Okay, this is the seal that came out of it. This is the wiper seal. You can see all the dirt and crap that was behind it. This was the secondary buffer seal, and it just came out in pieces. And this is the last buffer seal. It was actually still pliable. But when you got oil out, you got dirt in and water in. So let me show you what it did in here. So water's gotten in and rusted the wiper seal area and the first seal. So I'm gonna have to take emery paper and clean that up really good. But if you've got a cylinder that's leaking, it's got oil coming out, I promise you dirt is going back in. Okay, in order to get all the rust out of here, what I had to do was wad up some emery paper and get a hold of it with these pliers and run it around in there like this. Okay, this is the new buffer seal, and it's a two-piecer. So, as small as this hole is, I'm going to try to snap this in here and install it in one chunk. I don't know if that's going to work or not. This is where sausage fingers do not come in handy. Need a little kid to do this. Okay, I want to show you something interesting I noticed on this head. Okay, you see one mark for the locking screw
and one mark only. Now there's no way that a guy put that exactly back in the way that head was going to stop. So my guess is this cylinder has never been apart since 1977, which is the tag on the cylinder, the original cat tag. Okay, what you got to do to this, this is the U-cut buffer seal, or I mean the wiper seal, so you got to take some emery paper to this and clean it up, because you're gonna have to bearing mount it in. So what I do to clean this up before I do all that is I use alcohol to degrease it. Make it clean. And I wash my hands too, so I don't have human oil or any other contamination. And do the bore in here too. Make sure I get all the grease residue and whatever else out. So now this is what they call a vented buffer seal. You see the hole drilled in here? That way anything gets past this first lip, it just drains back inside here instead of pushing the seal out. Now what you gotta do is you gotta put this primer on. Then you use Loctite 609, which is a retaining compound. Need to put the wear ring on the piston. And then we gotta put the seal on. Did you go over the, look at the, where is your old one? Okay, what am I forgetting? Hope nothing. There we go. Blue stuff. Blue goo. Ooh, I gotta get one of those lock and lube deals. I hate this one. Gonna rain and the thunder and the thunder rolls. Oh, I gotta take plugs off. I ain't gonna work the plugs on. Dumbass. Not enough. Okay, this is the swivel valve off the motor grader. It was leaking. So I got all the O-rings in there, but now I've got to fit all these Teflon sealing rings in there. So that's my next mission here, is to try to get those in. I probably should grease them first. Maybe. See if they'll go in dry. There we go. Okay, I figured it out. Boy, that's going to be a bastard though, putting those ones clear down in there. My lord. That's gonna suck ass.
Good Friday morning to you, everybody. It's an awesome day working on the grader, getting ready to go to our new job. Want to give a shout out to some of my great subscribers. James Miller from Orkney, Scotland. Thank you, James, for subscribing all the way from Scotland. That's cool. Crystal Lewis from West Virginia. I met Robert and Crystal at the Kentucky Truck Show. Crystal, you look like a great big ball of fun. I really enjoyed meeting you. It was awesome. Serge K from Vancouver, Washington. Thank you, sir. And Bryden Gardner from Arizona says he lives around the same area as Reed Flake. Go check out his channel. It's called Rodeo Video. Anyway, thanks, Brian, for subscribing. Toolman TJ, he's from LaGrange, Wisconsin. Mike, he's from Renton, Washington. And Speciosa, he's from Valdez, Alaska. That's a long ways away. Thank you, sir. Anthony Forrett from Auburn, Washington. And Steve from KY, Kentucky, Kentucky. Danny Johnson from Summit, Missouri. Or is that Mississippi? I don't know. What is the abbreviation? Let me ask my phone. What is the abbreviation for Mississippi?
Here's what I found on the web for what is the abbreviation for Mississippi.
Well, that doesn't help me. Good Lord. Why can't I remember this? Danny Johnson from Summit, Mississippi. Thank you for subscribing, Danny. Had a special visitor yesterday all the way from Rochelle, Illinois. John Lindquist stopped by. John used to work for Quinn Caterpillar in California. And he's now back in Rochelle, Illinois, still working on truck engines and overhauling them. Anyway, it was awesome. John was on his way back from Washington, so he stopped by and we visited for a couple hours. He's got a lot of knowledge, and I loved it because he gave me a lot of tips and information that he's gathered over his 75 years of working on vehicles. Well, he's 75, he didn't work that long, but he's worked on trucks a long time and he's garnered a lot of knowledge, and it was awesome to meet you, John, and I hope you have a safe trip back to Illinois. Thank you for stopping by. I want to share this with you. Eric Saylor from Houston, Montana was recently in, I think he was in Maui. Anyway, he sent me these awesome cards because I told him he should have brought me with him. Anyway, great cards. Except for this one, Eric, you didn't have to send me that one. Anyway, it was awesome. Thank you. Okay, I want to look at some truck pictures. This first truck is from Mitchell Harvey. He says, the Western Star is the first truck I was driving in the patch in FSJ around 2010 with a Detroit hauling screw piles. The Peterbilt is an 87 with a white 425 Cat Corvette Dash hauling round bells on the ranch. Last one is a vac truck on the mean streets of Fort St. John with a message. Thanks for the Friday videos, Mitchell Harvey. Thank you, Mitchell. Okay, these next trucks are from Conrad. He's from Summerland, BC, Canada. He says, my brothers and I own an excavating and landscaping company. I have some truck pictures for you. The first one is a 97 Ford with a 300 horse 8.3 Cummins and a 9-speed. The second is a 93 Ford with a 4.25 3406B Cat and an 8LL. I really enjoy your videos. Well, thank you, Conrad. Okay, got some trucks and some equipment here. This is from Dallas Loken. He has a 98 CL 613, 454 horsepower and an 18-speed, a John Deere 772D with our homemade 12-wide snow pusher. Dallas is the president of Loken Excavating and Drainage. Okay, got a box today to open. Let's see what's inside. Hope it's not the package of extra small rubbers I ordered. Says Jay Grandpa got these when he toured. Grandpa got these when he toured Cat in Peoria? He was a county commissioner in Mitchell, South Dakota in the 1940s. I'm retired Boeing aircraft Everett Washington 2001. You might as well enjoy them. Love your show. Mike Rathy from Marysville, Washington. Oh, cool. Old timey. Caterpillar. Watch fob. God, I'm shaking. Look at that. I was drilling on that mailbox. Hard, really hard. Push. I can't hold still now. Stop it. Now, that's cool. Thanks, Mike. That's awesome. We'll hang it over here. So, here's my awesome friends from Maui, Russell and Mindy. Now, I gotta learn how to pronounce your last name. Hawaiian names are not my forte, so I'm not even gonna try. But Mindy, I love you for sending this to me. This is awesome. The macadamia nuts and the potato chips were delicious. And like I say, the box made it. Oh, and the potato chips are still in one piece. Ooh. Oh my gosh. Oh, you shouldn't have. Oh boy. Oh boy. Oh boy. I love it. Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness. Mandy. Oh, that's, oh my gosh. Look what she sent me. Oh, this is awesome. Maui Caramax, creamy caramel, and macadamias covered in milk chocolate. Kona Caramax, Kona coffee, infused caramel, macadamia covered in milk chocolate. Ooh. And these are Island Max. These are macadamians, chocolate covered ones. I love it. So I got candy, girls, potato chips. What else? What else? Oh, cool. A card. Hi, Jeff. Enjoy your snacks, but more the calendar. Thank you. Keep in touch. Russell and Mindy from Maui, Hawaii. That's awesome. Love these postcards, Mindy. That is cool. Okay, got a box of goodies from Rob and Terry Allward, and they're from down in Florida. He says, hello, Jeff. You bring a fun time for me watching your YouTube channel. Thank you for sharing your expertise. Enjoy the cat hats. The folder belonged to my godfather and are vintage. Enjoy or pass them along. Rob, I love what you sent me. Not sure I'm going to show it on YouTube, but those are awesome. Those are collector's items. It was awesome. But he did send me a couple cat hats. I love this. Thank you very much, Rob. These are nice. This will be my go-to-on-vacation hat. Keep these nice and clean. I love these hats. Thank you very much, Rob. Appreciate that.